Welcome to Second Take, the show that takes a look at the issues behind the news. Zimbabweans went to the polls on July 30, and ZANU-PF and President Emmerson Mnangagwa emerged victorious. But the opposition is challenging the results. Martin Zwakinyu joins me to discuss the outcome of the elections. Hi, Martin.
Hi, Chanel.
What is the likely reaction of the international community?
Well, we have already had reactions by the international community to the result of the general elections in Zimbabwe. All the African observer teams that were in the country, you know, starting with SADC, COMESA, and the African Union, they've all approved of the manner in which the elections were conducted. So as far as they are concerned, the elections were free, fair, and credible. They've got no problem at all. But now if you look at the reaction that we have had from the United States, the United Kingdom, and the European Union, you know, they seem to be singing a different tune altogether. The Americans have said that they are still studying the figures, you know, collated by their own observer mission in Zimbabwe, and also figures, you know, collected by other, you know, observer missions, you know, that way in Zimbabwe during the period of the elections. So, but they've made it very clear that at this point in time, you know, whatever pronouncement they make is pretty much preliminary. So we really don't know how the international community is going to be reacting, you know, apart from SADC, that is actually SADC, COMESA, and the AU, which have made their position very clear. You know, they are quite happy with the way the elections were held. But now we still have to await the reaction, the final reaction, final assessment of the Americans, the Europeans, and the United States government in particular. Yes.
How important were these elections for President Mnangagwa and the ruling party?
Okay, when you want to assess the importance of these elections to ZANU-PF and their presidential candidate, President Mnangagwa, you've got to look at the manner in which they came into government. You'll recall that in November 2017, the Zimbabwe Defense Forces staged a coup, although many people prefer to call it, you know, something else, but essentially it was a coup. And they realized that they didn't have legitimacy up until the elections were held. So they were very desperate to have those elections and to have them, you know, perceived as credible and fair by the international community, which is why for the very first time in Zimbabwe in the last 2 decades, you had observer missions from the United States, from the European Union, and from the Commonwealth as well, and from other parties that were perceived by Mugabe to be hostile to ZANU-PF and the Zimbabwe government at large. Yeah. So really the importance is that Mnangagwa wanted the legitimacy. I mean, all along he has been a coup leader, and others have gone to the extent of calling his government a junta government. And he wanted to sort of normalize, you know, his government for it to be perceived as a democratic, you know, as a fairly elected government. So it was indeed a very important election for the ZANU-PF government. As you might be aware, President Mnangagwa, since day one, has been going on, you know, about Zimbabwe being open for business. But he realized that people might take that to the pinch of salt if they realize that he came to office through the barrel of the gun, as it were. So he just wanted that to be cleared so that he can start, you know, on a clean page, you know, where he has legitimacy and credibility in the eyes of the international community. Yes.
Will the fact that the opposition is challenging the election outcome impact on President Mnangagwa's push to attract foreign direct investment?
I think it will, but we are assuming that the international community agrees with the opposition that the elections were rigged. You know, if the international community does agree with that, then it means his attempt, you know, to attract investment to the country, I don't know if it is going to be, to still be successful. I mean, there has been a lot of goodwill since he came to office. I mean, if the Zimbabweans are to be believed, so many people have been, you know, coming into Zimbabwe, not necessarily to invest at this stage, but to make inquiries about the opportunities that are there. We know that for many years, probably for decades, you know, there hasn't been that much investment in infrastructure I'm talking about roads, I'm talking about railways, you know, and other telecommunications, and so on and so forth. And also in the mining industry, which is quite important in Zimbabwe. You know, there hasn't been that much investment, you know, since the days of Robert Mugabe. I would say probably since around about the year 2000, people have been giving Zimbabwe, you know, a wide berth. They've been coming into Zimbabwe. So now Mnangagwa is desperate because he realizes that, okay, he might be wielding political power at this point in time, but he needs to translate that into some kind of economic influence, you know. He wants to be credible to the international community. But now with the opposition going to court now, what's going to happen is that people are beginning to doubt his sincerity, that he wants to start on a, you know, on a clean slate, you know, that he wants to really divorce the manner in which he does things, you know, from the Mugabe days. Now, the challenge by the opposition to me is a bit problematic for him. You know, the Americans, they've already, you know, hinted, although that's not the final pronouncement, but they've already hinted that, you know, there were issues with the manner in which the elections were held. I mean, people have mentioned, you know, bias on the part of the state media, both television and the newspapers, you know, against the opposition. They've talked about, you know, abuse of state resources during the campaign period. And now the opposition is actually complaining about perceived fraud in the manner in which the elections were conducted. And the Americans, they've pretty much said that, you know, they believe what the opposition is saying. So that is going to be problematic for the push by Mnangagwa to woo international investors. You must remember that at this point in time, Zimbabwe is under sanctions, you know, under US sanctions. Yeah, there are financial restrictions, and there are also movement restrictions on particular individuals. I know some people would say that, I mean, but barring Mugabe, for instance, and top ZANU-PF officials from going to the United States, I mean, how does that affect, you know, the president's efforts to bring in investment? But you've got to realize that the Americans, I mean, you know, they've got a lot of influence. Once the Americans say country A, B, C, and countries A, B, C, and D are problematic, I mean, the rest of the world will listen. I mean, if you look at the moment, the World Bank is not in Zimbabwe right now. And that came after the Americans had made pronouncements about the way Mugabe was governing the country. And after the World Bank sort of withdrew, the International Monetary Fund did exactly the same. And pretty much every major international financial institution in Zimbabwe, you know, they sort of withdrew from the country after the action by the United States back in 2000. So for as long as the Americans are not favorable, you know, in terms of their disposition to Zimbabwe, I think Mnangagwa is going to find it very difficult to attract investors into Zimbabwe to kickstart the recovery of the economy.
Thank you. That's the Second Take Show for this week. Thank you for watching, and join us again next time for more news analysis.